Hello everyone, welcome to this class once again. Today's class will be talking about the next 5 questions of laws of motion. Already we have done the first 5 questions in the previous class. In the previous class we saw some good questions based upon laws of motion, and we are continuing with the same NEET pattern exercise. Now the next 5 questions are quite good questions which are suited for your NEET examination. Let's go ahead with the 6th question. That is, after 5 questions we have practiced, let's go with the 6th one. A mass of 1 kg is suspended by a thread. It is first lifted up with an acceleration 4.9 meter per square second, second lowered with an acceleration 4.9 meter per square second. The ratio of the tension is A, 3 is to 1, B, 1 is to 3, C, 1 is to 2, D, 2 is to 1. I hope that you have understood with the statement of the question what is the thing that is happening. A block is there which is suspended by a string. Once you are lifting up the block and once you are bringing the block in the downward direction. Let's see what is the tension created during both the cases while lifting and while descending it downward. See, the first case is this. This is the block. It is made to lift up. It's going up. Its mass is given as 1 kg. Acceleration is given as 4.9 meter per square second. That is what is happening. Let's say the tension generated in the string is T. So if I draw a free body diagram of M, we will be having M here, Mg is acting downwards, and tension T1, let's say that tension acting is T1, so I'll mark here T1, it will be acting along the upward direction. Acceleration A equals to 4.9 meter per square second, that is what is actually the acceleration of the block. So from here we can write down T1 minus Mg is equal to M into A, or T1 comes out to be Mg plus A, equation number 1. So for the first part, during the time of ascent, we have evaluated what is the tension that would be there in the string. Now let's go to the second part. The second part, well, the case when it was coming down. In the case of coming down, see, again the picture will be somewhat like this. M will be here, Mg will be acting on downward direction, tension T will be, again it will be there. Only change, acceleration is acting along the downward direction. Both the cases the value of acceleration is same. Now let me draw the free body diagram in the second case. In the second case, the free body diagram, if I show Mg acting along again downward direction, tension, let's say it is T2. We are using for the second one, let's use the tension as T2. So you will be having, if the acceleration A is acting downward, so Mg minus T2 is equal to M into A. Quite obvious, T2 will turn out to be Mg minus A, equation number 2. Only thing that we need to do, we have to put the values. Prior to that, T1, T2 we have. We need to find out the ratio. The question is saying, what is the ratio of tension during the both the cases? So I'm going to rub one part. So T1 by T2, I believe that you must be remembering the value of T1, that was Mg plus A, and T2 that was Mg minus A. So clearly MMM cancels out. G plus A upon G minus A. G, let's use it as 9.8 plus 4.9. This will be 9.8 minus 4.9. We will be having this as 14.7 in the numerator and 4.9 in the denominator. This turns out to be 3 times it will go. So we'll be having 3 is to 1. This will be the ratio, 3 is to 1. Let's check option number A. 3 is to 1, rest, 1 is to 2, 2 is to 1, 1 is to 3, all the 3 will be incorrect. A will be the correct answer. So while calculating the tensions, this is the procedure, these are the steps that you need to follow to find out the tension. Now, again with this question, you should remember, while taking up, the tension is Mg plus A. While coming down, the tension is Mg minus A. Remember this thing. That will be very much helpful to directly switch on to the solution of the problem, and you need not to follow more steps. These are the basic. I have actually used the basics to actually find out the solution. Once you practice more and once you get used to, you'll be directly using the equations to reach on to the result. Let's go with the next question of the class. Seventh one, a ball of mass 150 gram moving with an acceleration 20 meter per square second is hit by a force. A force is applied on a ball which acts on it for 0.1 second. The impulsive force is A.5, B.1, C.3, D.1.2. All are in proper SI units. Ball of mass 150 gram. So let me write down the values that has been provided. Ball of mass 150 gram, that is equal to 0.15 kg. Moving with an acceleration 20 meter per square second is hit by a force. Acceleration is 20 meter per square second. Is hit by a force. You see here is hit by a force which acts on it for 0.1 second. The impulsive forces we need to find out. We need to find out what is the force that has been applied. The impulsive force we need to find out. And time is provided. So, can we find out after acceleration what is the force will be applied? That will be given as mass into acceleration. Multiplied with time, you will get the impulsive force. So, mass into acceleration will come out to be, you see here, m into a will turn out to be 0.15 multiplied with 20 is equal to 0.15 into 20, that will turn out to be 1.5 into 3. 3 we got, 0.15 into 20 we did. Next thing, which acts on it for 0.1 second? Impulsive force, impulse we need to talk about, that is actually force into time. So impulse if we talk about, that is equal to force into time. This in SI units we have done. So 3 multiplied with 0.1, this comes out to be 0.3 newton second. With proper SI units, 0.3. Let's check the options. A, incorrect. B, incorrect. C is the correct answer. So for this, impulsive force will be 0.3 newton second. Quite easily we can solve for impulse. Remember, impulse is force into time, or you can say change in momentum. This is how we have to find out. Next one, question number 8, the upper half of an inclined plane of inclination theta is perfectly smooth while lower half is rough. A block starting from rest at the top of the plane will again come to rest at the bottom if the coefficient of friction between the block and the lower half of the plane is given by A, mu goes to 1 upon tan theta, B, mu goes to 2 upon tan theta, C, mu goes to 2 tan theta, D, mu goes to tan theta. Which option matches with the right answer? Let's see here. The case is somewhat like this. This inclined plane. Now, we have, this is the half part. Let's say total length is L. So, this length will be L by 2 and this length will be L by 2. Quite obvious. Object will be coming here. This part is smooth. This first half is smooth as per the given information. The lower half is rough where mu is provided. It's given that at the top of the plane will again come to rest at the bottom if the coefficient of friction between the block and the lower half of the plane is given by. We need to find out the value of mu. So that's what I have marked mu is equal to question mark. Let's see. Now, one thing, if you see, it comes freely till here. Then again, resistive force act during its motion from this point to this point. The work done by the force mg sine theta, you see here the force acting here, we have to also use the concept of work energy. Don't worry about it, very simple concept we'll be using. Now see, force acting on it. Mg is here, this will be theta. So this will be mg sine theta. I believe that this all you know how to resolve the forces. Mg sine theta will do a work till it comes down. Frictional force acts only during this case. Friction force will be how much? It's a case of maximum friction force since the block is sliding. So mu into n, that will be maximum friction force. Now you see here, to stop it, work done by mg sine theta will be equal to work done by frictional force. These are the two forces acting along parallel to incline. Work done by friction force. Now friction that will be acting, F that will be max. The only friction force, since it is sliding, we have to talk about the limiting case, mu into n. I believe that you must be remembering n should be equal to mg cos theta. Now let's use the concept of work done by mg sin theta. That will turn out to be mg sin theta force into distance, that is equal to L, and mu mg cos theta work done by friction force, mu mg cos theta multiplied by L by 2. Because the friction force is only acting for the length L by 2, see here, L cancel out, mg cancel out, you will be having mu is equal to 2 sin theta divided by cos theta. Mu is equal to 2 tan theta, that is what we will be reaching finally. Mu is equal to 2 tan theta, this will be the final result. Quite simple and obvious to reach on to the result. Let's see which option matches. C, mu is 2 tan theta, rest are incorrect and incorrect. This is how you have to solve. I have used the concept of work energy, simple concept I have used. Work done, you must be knowing that force into distance, that much you can apply if you are not aware about the work energy principle, then also you can apply such basic concepts of work energy. That is what I have shown you here. Next part, question number 9. A block B is pushed momentarily along a horizontal surface with an initial velocity v. If mu is the coefficient of sliding friction between B and surface, block B will come to rest after a time. We need to find out after how much time it's going to come to rest. You see here, A is given as V by G mu, B G mu by V, C G by V, D V by G. First of all, you can check, you need to find out the time. So which one is actually correct as per dimensional analysis? You can check that and you can eliminate some options. If I check option number A, V by G mu, the unit of V is meter per second, and unit of g is meter per square second. So that is, A can be correct. You will get second as the unit in A. So this is dimensionally correct. This is dimensionally incorrect. So you can eliminate option of B. This is dimensionally incorrect. G by V, again, this is dimensionally incorrect. V by G, again, this can be correct. So two options can be correct, V by G and V by G mu. Let's check which option will be correct. Rest two options we have eliminated as per the concept of dimensional analysis that I've also told you how you can use the concept of dimensional analysis in finding the solution, in eliminating some options in your answer. Now see here, this block B sliding. It's given a velocity V. Let's me show you here. This is the surface over which this block B slides. Given a velocity V, coefficient is mu. Now you see here, as it slides, the deacceleration acting on it will be how much? That will be equal to mu into g. Why is that? Because n is acting here, weight is acting here. If its weight is mg, normal reaction will be equal to mg. Frictional force acting is equal to mu into n, that is equal to mu into mg. Hence, deacceleration, that will be produced, that will be equal to mu into g. Quite obvious, because frictional force divided by mass, so that will be mu into g. Now you see, we got the deacceleration. We need to stop the body. Time taken, now see, final velocity is 0. Final velocity of the body is 0, use v equals to u minus at. T will come out to be u minus v by a, and hence we'll be having u. You see here, u is actually given as v and v is 0, a is given as mu g. So v by mu g will be the answer for the time. Let's go ahead, v by mu g, that is option number a. and hence you can eliminate option number D. This is how you can solve such questions in your NEET examination. Let's go ahead with the next problem. Next problem of the class, question number 10. A ball of mass 3 kg moving with a speed 100 meter per second strikes a wall at an angle 60 degree. You see here a ball strikes an angle of 60 degree. As shown in figure, the ball rebounds at the same speed and remains in contact with the wall for 0.2 second. Ball rebounds with the same speed and making angle same 60 degree with the horizontal, with the vertical, sorry, with the wall, you see here. And its time of contact is 0.2 second. The force exerted by the ball on the wall is, force exerted by the ball on the wall is A, 1500 root 3 Newton, B, 1500 Newton, C, 300 root 3 Newton, and D, 300 Newton. Let's see how to do. First of all, let me show you the scenario here. What's happening? This is the wall. We have a ball which is actually made to hit. It hits here. We have a wall, ball. This is the ball. It's made to hit. This is the angle, 60 degree. Now see, it will be having two momentum. If I make its momentum, it will be having two momentum. One here, it's, if its velocity is V, so we'll be having, this is 60 degree. Quite obvious, you can say that how much component will be acting here and how much component will be along the vertical. That you can make out. Now see, 60 degree is this, this will be automatically 30 degree. So we'll be having MV cos 30 degree momentum at this end, and here we'll be having MV sine 30 degree. We are not concerned about this, I'm not writing this. MV sine 30 degree, you can write it. As the ball rebounds, you see again this angle is 60 degree. The velocity is along this direction. Again, the ball will be having two momentum. You see, this is 60 degree. Automatically, you can find out which will be angle and where you have to make out. You see, this is 60 degree. Automatically, again, this will be 30 degree. You can make out. So you'll be having the momentum final here along this direction. We'll be having MV cos 30 degree. And this will be MV sine 30 degree. Now see, on the ball, let's talk about on the wall. The momentum along the wall is not changing, but the momentum perpendicular to wall is changing. So if I talk about change in momentum of ball, delta P of ball, you see here, this is along the wall and this is just opposite to wall. If we take this side as positive, and this side as negative, we'll be having P final minus P initial, that is equal to MV cos 30 degree minus P initial minus MV cos 30 degree. So we got MV cos 30 degree minus MV cos 30 degree, that will be 2MV cos 30 degree. Now we need to find out what is the force acting on the ball due to the wall. First of all, let's try to find out what is the force acting on the ball. So force will be what? Delta P by delta T, and that will come out to be delta T, you see, it's 0.2 second. Divided by 0.2. Let us put the values. We have the ball of mass 3 kg. Moving with the velocity, you see here, its velocity would be given 100 meter per second. So 3 kg, 100 meter per second. 2 into 3 into 100 cos 30 degrees root 3 by 2 divided by, you see here, 0.2. Now you can see that I am going to eliminate. This will go 10 times, or you can see here straight away it's going 10 times, and then we are having 3 by 2 will give you 1.5, and 1.5 multiplied by 1000 will come out to be 1500 root 3 Newton. This is the, we have actually resolved for force on the ball. This is force on the ball. From Newton's third law, if the force on the ball by the wall is this much, the same amount of force the ball will be exerting on the wall. That is why from Newton's third law we can say that the same force will be on the wall also, because you need to find out the force exerted by the ball on the wall. Again, that will be same 1500 root 3 Newton, and that will be towards this side. Because on the ball, it was towards this side, as I have shown you here, the momentum changes along this direction. So on the wall, it will be towards this side. And the magnitude will be A, 1500 root 3 Newton. This is the right answer. B, incorrect. C, incorrect. D, incorrect. Let me mark this as the right answer. Hope that you have understood this question. This was a very good question, and you have understood how to solve such kind of question. Now, what you do after the class, do practice questions. As much practice you do, you'll find that your application of concepts will be improved, and your accuracy and speed both will be enhanced. So do practice more to score more in your examination. I wish you all the very best. I'll meet you with some more questions in the coming topic in the next class. Thank you, everyone.